फ्रेंड्स, इन दिस एपिसोड ऑफ पॉपुलर अवेयरनेस सीरीज ऑफ नेशनल कैंपेन फॉर डाइवर्सिटी एंड हार्मनी वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस वीमेन फंडामेंटलिज्म एंड आरएसएस। नाउ व्हाई आई एम एडिंग फंडामेंटलिज्म आल्सो इन दिस एपिसोड इज बिकॉज एज फार एज वीमेन आर कंसर्न, सिमिलर आइडियाज लाइक दैट ऑफ आरएसएस आर आल्सो हेल्ड by other fundamentalist groups like Christian fundamentalists, which came up in America in 1920, then Islamic fundamentalist of Ayatollah Khomeini in Iran, then those of Taliban. Most of these organizations which operate in the name of religion, which do politics in the name of religion, which try to impose gender hierarchies under the guise of religion, most of these organizations by and large are male dominated. What to say of male dominated? As far as RSS is concerned, RSS is a exclusively male organization. If you see the word RSS, the full form is Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. The subordinate women's organization is Rashtra Sevika Samiti. And in the very title, the word Sevika is missing. Sevika is missing, and as we see in earlier episodes, they uphold Manusmriti and they glorify the values of the past in which the condition of women was subordinate to that of men, to the extent that women were regarded as property of men in the so-called ancient glorious values. And of course, obviously, the first expression of this comes in the form of Manusmriti. Now, how was Rashtra Sevika Samiti formed? Rashtra Sevika Samiti was formed in 1936 by Lakshmibai Kelkar, one of the relatives of a RSS worker. She approached Kesho Baliram Hedgewar, Sir Sangachalak of RSS, saying that they also want to join RSS. Now, she was told that RSS is a male organization, so you can go and form a subordinate organization called Rashtra Sevika Samiti. Now, their functions are different. Many times their trainings are on similar line, but RSS regards that the primary function of women is to take care of family, and they see women primarily as a mother in the society who rears the children. And this is quite similar to the concept of women in Germany in 1930s, 40s, when they were looked at as a producer of children. And the three functions which were attributed to them were kitchen, church and children. So on the similar lines, the things here are there. So on one hand is Rashtra Sevika Samiti, then BJP has its own women's wing. And in this BJP's women's wing, we can come across at least some of the leaders who are worth quoting. One such leader of BJP Mahila Morcha was Vijaya Raje Shindia. Actually, she was a vice president of BJP. Now, in the context of Sati of Roop Kavar, which took place in Rajasthan, there was a great uproar amongst those people who were working for equality in the society, amongst women's groups, amongst human rights groups. There was a great uproar. At that time, Vijaya Raje Shinde took out a procession, morcha, on the parliament with some women. And the slogan of the morcha was that the women of India not only have a glorious tradition of committing sati, but they also have a right to commit sati. Of course, interestingly, Mrs. Shindia never exercised her own right, as her husband had died few years ago. Now, this is as far as Shindia is concerned. Now, there was another woman who later on also became governor of Goa, Mridula Sinha. She was actually part of BJP Mahila Morcha, and in one of the interviews in Savvy magazine in April 1994, she said that women should generally not work outside the home unless it is very mandatory, very much essential, that she did say that I gave dowry for my daughter's marriage, I got dowry for my son's marriage, and if husband is beating a wife, it is for the good of the family, for to maintain the family, etc., etc. So this is on one side what we see. And lately there is another younger organization from amongst the women's groups, and that is Durga Vahini. Durga Vahini is a female version of Bajrang Dal, which is given the training in arms and other things on the pretext that you have to protect yourself from those people, especially the Muslims who want to who have evil eye upon you, etc., etc. So this is as far as women's thing is concerned. And if we see that their attitude towards women and girls is that of being subordinate, this is shown at many a times, especially on Valentine Day. Many a Bajrang Dal workers, they organize the programs where they advise the girls not to wear jeans. Lately, Valentine Day has also been opposed, and they say this is a Western tradition, it should not be celebrated. And one of the person of similar ideology, you all must be knowing his name, Asaram Bapu, currently who is in jail for being involved in the cases of rape. That is just the little iceberg, tip of the iceberg, which we know. So Asaram Bapu suggested that Valentine Day should not be celebrated, and instead it should be celebrated as Matra Pitra Pujan Divas, means the day for worshipping your parents. Now this is on one side. Then one recalls that one RSS Pracharak, who was one RSS Pracharak, Pramod Butalik, he had formed Sri Ram Sene, and this Sene in Mangalore went on to attack girls who were returning from a pub. So this again showed the type of attitude they have towards the equality of girls and all that. For them, girls trying to have equal status is a Western concept which is not suitable for Indian society. And recently the RSS chief Shri Mohan Bhagwat also went on to say that the percentage of rapes is more in urban areas than in the rural areas. Now this is of course a figment of imagination, because in rural areas also there are number of cases of rape against poor women, against Adivasis and those coming from Dalit communities. Similarly, Bhagwat Sahab also went on to say that divorce is also something more in cities, and this is because of the arrogance of the partners. Actually, divorce, the very concept of divorce hinges around the fact that both the partners in the marriage should be comfortable with each other. It has nothing to do with arrogance or ego. It has more to do with incompatibility of the partners. But basically, as they are opposed to equality of women, they have also floated a word called love jihad. Now, interestingly, whenever a Hindu girl marries a Muslim boy, it is called love jihad. Now many, and there was a report float, they have brought out booklets also warning Hindu girls to be not to come close to Muslim boys, not to be friends with them. Now this book basically revolves around that there is an organization which is funding Muslim youth, giving them motorcycles and mobiles to lure the Hindu girls. Now this, of course, many cases were investigated, and it came to light that there is no such organization promoting Muslim youth. Normally, in a society, open society, where there is an interaction between people of different religions, different castes, inter-caste and inter-religion marriages do take place. And as Baba Sahab said, one of the ways to eradicate the caste is inter-caste marriages. See, on the same lines, one can argue that one of the methods of promoting communal amity is to promote inter-religious marriages. Now here at the end I would like to recall the case of Hadia, who was Akhila. She came in contact with a Muslim boy, they fell in love, they got married, and she became Hadia. She was a medical intern in a medical college. She was an adult, but because of the biased minds, even the smaller courts did not permit her to stay with her husband. They gave her custody to her father. Later on, when the case went to the Supreme Court, fortunately, Supreme Court heard her case and they opined that she is an adult girl, she has a full right to choose her life partner. So this is how we see that this whole campaign of Love Jihad is targeted to defame Muslim youth as being the ones who are eyeing on Hindu girls. The matter is that it's a sort of a social interaction because of which such alliances, etc., take place. Secondly, and more importantly, Charu Gupta, one of the eminent sociologists, in her articles in EPW and other places, points out that Love Jihad, its primary goal is to restore the hegemony of men over girls, over women. Means the head of the family controls the lives of the girls in the family. So this is probably one of the major goals as why Love Jihad came up in the society. So as far as the condition of women is concerned, of course one concedes that there are many BJP women MPs. But as far as ideology is concerned, this RSS ideology of Hindu nationalism on these matters is very close to the other fundamentalist tendencies like Christian fundamentalism, Islamic fundamentalism, which give secondary subordinate position to the women. And here, as RSS subtly, covertly, overtly wants to promote Manusmriti, in Manusmriti, women are given the status of Shudrati Shudra, means being the lowest category as far as the hierarchy, social hierarchy is concerned. So now time has come that people give a thought to it as to any religious nationalism, any nationalism in the name of religion cannot give equality to women on one side, poor Dalits, farmers on the other side. So this is a part of their political agenda, political goal, which they want to bring in through their politics. Thank you very much.